Punjab government, and we learned these skills from the foreign doctors. Then we have the course at Udiyaka for the animal handlers, and now we have started with veterinary holders in partnership with Human Society International. We have launched another 12 courses. We have already finished it two courses now, and going ahead for the other with the help of foreign doctors and Jaipur Veterinary Medical Center and helping supply. This is Dr. John Jaffers, who had inaugurated the Jaipur Veterinary course. These are the comments from our trainees who have finished with our course, and they were really happy with the training that they got from here before the surgery and after. They have sent us the feedback. Mainly the capacity building that the people are doing, like the doctors from Odisha government, Dr. Swan, had written to us, even after completion of the course, they themselves started training the other government doctors in their area. Thus, the Veterinary India project is helping Indian veterinary personnel to improve the aseptic surgical techniques, appropriate analgesia and anesthesia procedures, effective and human understanding, human transporting, housing and anesthetic of dogs, improved record keeping, improved surgical techniques, resulting in minimal post-surgical complications.
Working to ensure what we do. About the very discovery development and the manufacture of the TB vaccines and medicines. We have 5,000 plus students worldwide, including 800 plus veterinary R&D scientists and specialists dedicated for the TA, which is Agile Market. And we have a diverse portfolio of leading veterinary products and services for livestock and companion animals. We operate from 60 plus countries all around the world. TA is R&D network. We have 8 dedicated R&D networks for the pipeline. We have a presence in Alaska, Alaska, Spain, UK, Belgium, and one plant in India. We have a platform for the main building. And this is a facility where we are providing the vaccines for the global market. At the same time, we will be importing for India. Then the evolution is ongoing with 7 up to the topic of classes for the part 1 and 3.
Introduce myself. My name is Dr. V.M. Chariyar. I'm from Bombay. I'm a veterinary surgeon in practice since 1995. And I welcome you to watch a laparoscopic oophorectomy, a laparoscopic spay in a female patient provided to us by the International Animal Rescue Hospital in Goa. So we have a team from International Animal Rescue and they're taking care of the anesthetic, and they're making sure that the patient is happy, healthy, fit and fine while we go ahead and do this procedure. So I'll speak with you as we go, and then I'll have a short presentation, and I can take some interactive or some questions at the end. Okay? Thank you. So I'll just start with an outline of what equipment we have out here, and you will see it on your screen. So can we have the mix? So we have a few pieces of equipment, and the audio visual is letting us watch it on the screen. So first of all, we have equipment 1, 2, 3, and 4. So there are 4 pieces of equipment which you can see on screen. So the first is what is called the video camera. Yeah, that's the video camera. Then there is an electrosurgical unit. Then there is an insufflator. And there is a light source. So what are these instruments? First and foremost, when we enter into a patient's abdominal cavity, then there is no light there. It's all very dark, and therefore you cannot see anything. So first thing what we will do is we will create some space, and we'll shed some light in the cavity. And because there is space and light, thereafter there will be vision as well. Okay? So these are the few pieces of equipment that come together to form a unit for laparoscopy. And I think we will discuss some more as we go. So first and foremost, what I will be doing is we will be inflating the peritoneal cavity with some gas. And once there is space between organs, and we can shed light into these organs and see them on screen. Okay? So many of you have watched surgery in general. Some of you might be professionals. Some of you might be part of institutes and animal birth control programs. So surgery is something that you probably have watched. This is just surgery by a slightly different method, probably less invasive. Probably there is a smaller incision, and maybe you will not see much by way of blood on screen. Okay? So we'll go ahead. I will be first placing a tiny needle entry into the abdomen, and that will permit us to create space into this peritoneal cavity. Okay? So you probably can see this on screen, and there is a small needle here. So it's a very fine safety needle. So the needle has entered into the peritoneal cavity, and we are beginning to see that the abdomen is swelling up a little. And as it swells up, there is space between organs, and we can begin to view the organs inside now. Okay? So this is what is called a light source. So you can see it sheds light outside. and it can direct light into the patient's abdominal cavity as well. Now this is what is called a telescope, and the light is being shed in through the telescope by what is called a light source. And this is a camera head which will get attached to this telescope, and we can view the insides of inside organs in this patient very well. Okay, so some of you are professionals and some of you have an understanding of the anatomy as well. So what we see now on the screen are the internal organs of this female patient. This is what is called the urinary bladder. This is the colon. It's a tubular organ which holds the stool before it is excreted out by the patient. This is another organ called the spleen. Atul, thoda light bada do. This is the liver. And some of you might be familiar with this picture. This is the appearance of the liver. Now, that's the patient's heart. It's beating on the other side of the diaphragm. So it's actually in the chest cavity, but you can see the apex of the heart touching the diaphragm from time to time. So it's quite a splendorous view of God's creation. You can see brilliantly some of these organs which you would not otherwise be able to see. So that's the liver. That's a small gallbladder nestled between the liver lobes. That's a small gallbladder there, and these are all intestinal loops. Okay, the trocar. So we are going in with an accessory portal now, and you can see this on screen. There's another instrument that's coming into view, and this is a tubular metallic instrument which will permit operative instruments to be placed inside. No, pick up the monopolar cable. Okay, so now we will see the operative part of this procedure. We have visualized the internal organs. Now we have instruments which permit us to manipulate, to pick up and dissect, or to perform surgical procedure within this abdominal cavity. For this is the kidney that we can see. This is the kidney. It's a kidney shaped kidney. You can see it's shaped like a bean, and next to this is where is the ovary. Now that's the uterus of this patient, this long linear uterus. And I'm sure many of you might have seen this kind of uterus that has been removed from a patient following a spaying procedure. So So these two instruments which are in there will permit us to manipulate organs. Watch that screen, watch this one. So this is the ovary that I'm able to see now. That's the uterus and this is the ovary. And in a bloodless manner, we will be able to extract this ovary and complete this paying procedure in this patient. That's the bean, that is the ovary. So you can see that we are able to use an energy source, and because we are able to use an energy source, this is a procedure that we are able to do in a bloodless manner. So there's no blood that really is lost while we extract this ovary from this patient. Okay, so it's a dry field. The ovary is in our grasp, and we are ready to pull this ovary out, and this patient's ovariectomy on one side is now complete. So that's the ovary, and it's a 5 to 6 millimeter sized ovary, and we can readily take this out and proceed onto the other side. So once again, you can see all the bowels and intestines in this patient quite clearly. And because we have let in gas into this cavity, it has created space between organs, and it permits us to see very clearly on screen as to what exactly we are having to do. So once again, next to the kidney is where this other side ovary would be. And yeah, that's it. Here. So typically it takes probably 5 to 7 minutes to complete this procedure, and this is the ovary and that is the uterus. So the uterus typically leads to the ovary, and it's next to the kidney. If you look down below here, that's the kidney, and that's the ovaries on this patient. Atul, foot switch. नहीं फुट स्विच यहां दे देना या थैंक्स So once again, because we use energy source, you can see some vapor on the screen, and this energy source seals blood vessels before we free the tissue which is connecting the ovary into the patient. So as we free this, because we use energy, there is no blood loss. You see that there is no bleeding, and this is really patient friendly, because you see there has been no blood lost in this patient's surgery at all. So just to go back to where we were, that's where the ovary was. Behind that is where the kidney is. That's the kidney, and that's the field from which we removed the ovary, and it's really bloodless and spectacular field. If I were to want to undergo surgery, I would want to lose no blood in surgery, and I have lost no blood in this patient's surgery. Okay, so once again, these are the intestines, and it's a really nice view. It's good to see God's creation in this way, in a bright and brilliant manner every day. So that's the urinary bladder, and we can inspect. So there are many more things we can do laparoscopically than just pay our patients. We can examine the internal organs. Now this patient's liver seems happy and healthy. It's quite bright and nice. That's the blue colored pear shaped gallbladder in there. Once again, that's the heart beating against the diaphragm. Okay, and it's a really nice and splendorous view. Okay, so typically it takes about 5 to 7 minutes. If I were not to be speaking with you, then and I would only be doing what I'm doing, then it would take me 5 to 7 minutes to complete this procedure. And typically I will have another table where a patient is being readied for surgery, and I will just go from this table to the other table while one of my associates just takes a tiny stitch to close up the incision on this patient. Okay? Will you want to close up? It's a really tiny puncture that we have to use to place what is called a 5 millimeter instrument, and therefore it's a really tiny closure to do as well. No, a simple interrupted stitch, sir. Sorry. So what I typically do is exclude the skin. So all layers except the skin are part of this stitch. And the skin might be glued together, or you might place a simple stitch on it. We let all the gas out. Yeah. When after I remove the instrument, the gas just seeps out. So what? Automatically. Or I typically just place a thumbosep like that and just part it. So as soon as you create space, the gas just comes out. And normally you would have some overhead lights, and you could see this very well. So once again, it's a stitch that excludes the skin. So you have a choice of taking a separate stitch on the skin or just placing a drop of glue there, and that skin incision will close. Yeah. They seal, and therefore we are able to dissect it clean without any blood loss. So ovarian vessels, no. Yeah. So we've just completed this surgery. Will you do the skin now? Okay. Yeah. So we've just completed this surgery and I'm free to speak with you now. All good, Nikhil? Perfect. So, yeah, thank you, Nikhil. Nikhil confirms that our patient is doing fine and he has been watchfully attending her while I've been busy operating. So, Dr. Jaya is just closing up. There's a single stitch to be placed on the skin and you probably see it on screen. You can't see it very well, but it's a very tiny puncture incision. It's like a 5 millimeter puncture. So what is a 5 millimeter puncture? It is smaller than the buttonhole in my shirt. So it's very small, and typically we might even place a small drop of glue there to just seal the skin closed, and that's fine. And it's also fine if we just take a simple stitch, and this stitch does not need removal because there is a stitch in the sheath which is holding the incision closed, and that is the real protection for this patient. So a shot of antibiotic, a shot of painkiller, and maybe a day or two later, this patient is going to be fit and fine to go back into her own world. Okay? Laptop. Okay.
Last year I was concentrating on the patient and I was taking some time to speak with you, but now I'm totally free to speak with you because we have completed the procedure. And I'd like to speak with you about what has been a deeply personal and fulfilling journey of using laparoscopy for more and more patients over the last dozen years. So, I'm V.M. Charya, I'm from Bombay. I've been a surgeon and largely working with small animals for the last 15 years. So, our journey with laparoscopy is an interesting journey. Because when I first entered the world of laparoscopy, I was not sure that it's going to reach out to so many patients in such a short period of time. Then when I first started working with laparoscopy, and laparoscopy is something that all of us have heard about, and we know a dear friend or a relative or somebody in our family or extended family who has been through a laparoscopy procedure. So we know somebody whose gallbladder was infected. We know somebody whose appendix needed to be removed, and these patients these people in who are close to us would walk into a hospital and have a laparoscopic procedure and walk out of the hospital the same day or the next day and maybe go back to work after 3 or 4 days. And this is what laparoscopy or endoscopy has done to so many of our near and dear ones who happen to need a surgery. So there are any number of women who needed a uterine procedure or an ovarian procedure that needed to be done, and they got the benefit of not needing a wide open incision, and they got the benefit of pinhole incisions, which permitted them to go back to work, to go back to their lives without a lot of surgical injury, a lot of surgical insult. And whether we can use this for our small animal patients is the thought that kind of, you know, kept appearing in my mind. And therefore, in the late 1990s, when I first started working with laparoscopy, I typically was working with human surgeon friends. So I didn't have my own equipment. I didn't have our own setup to use. But for one patient, for another patient, I would typically take help from human surgeon friends, maybe borrow some equipment from them, put together a kit, and do a surgery, do another surgery. And thus way, in 1999, I first presented India's operative laparoscopy scientific publication, India's first scientific publication in laparoscopy in small animals in the Chennai symposium of what is called the Indian Society for Veterinary Surgery. So in 1999, I first presented this paper on believe it or not, on laparoscopic ovarian hysterectomy. So this involved removal of the uterus and ovaries. And this was a short series of cases that I had the privilege to present. And in our surgical fraternity, I was given an award for this paper. And that spurred me on to continue working in laparoscopy. So this was a time when, like many of us, I did not have access to my own equipment. I did not have access to my own laparoscope. I did not have all those equipments which I showed you on screen today. And typically I was borrowing them from a human surgeon for use on one patient and returning it to them the next day. So what this really did was it caused me to start thinking about how I can use this in more and more patients and how more patients can benefit. Because I have come to believe that a surgery or an innovation or a treatment is really valuable if it can reach out to many more patients. If it can reach out to 5 patients, then it's fine. If it can reach out to 25 patients, it's more valuable. And if it can reach out to many more than that, then it's probably even much more valuable. And then in my quest for using this as a beneficial procedure for many more patients, I worked on simplifying this procedure. And how to make this simpler was a part that would keep me really agitated at times. And in this quest for simplification, we were really fortunate that in our city we had to set up a stray dog neutering program, and the city was amenable to this part of using a new and patient friendly technology for using this to benefit stray animals who might not really be paying us anything. So in 2003 we set up this first stray dog neutering program using laparoscopy in the city of Thane. So Thane is a sister city of Bombay. It's like a twin or satellite city of Bombay, and many of you might know. So it was in this city in 2003 that we set forth using laparoscopy to reach out to many more patients and for the benefit of stray or feral animals who would be on the streets of the city. So from 2003 till now, over these 9 years, this program has reached out to nearly 40,000 dogs on the street, and maybe more than 60% of the street dogs in Thane city have benefited from this short stay procedure, from a procedure that would not need the dogs to be staying in our center for longer than the third day following surgery. So third day following surgery was patients are fit and fine for release to be sent back to their regular outdoor environment, because we don't inflict huge surgical insult on these patients. It's because we don't open up these patients, because there are not series of stitches which can later open, or this patient can chew, and some of these patients do, that these patients can go back into their environment in a short while. So what are the innovations that we undertook, and what are these things that have really been patient friendly? So what causes this procedure to become patient friendly is the use of 3 5-millimeter ports. So you just saw that we used really tiny incisions. The instruments are really slender, and they are about the size of a ballpoint pen refill. And since these instruments are so small, we are able to do this by using 5-millimeter bottles, and that makes this procedure truly minimally invasive. So there are many of these innovations have altered the textbooks. When we started, the textbook had several prescriptions on how we do laparoscopy, but we invented and reinvented this procedure for the benefit of our patients, and therefore it stands so much simplified. In 2003, before I set up this program, the standard international literature on laparoscopy in small animals said that this procedure consumed between 60 and 80 minutes. You see now that this procedure consumed between 6 and 8 minutes. So in a health set theater where we do this every day, it probably consumes not more than 8 minutes per procedure. So there are several of these innovations that converted this procedure into a readily usable procedure. It reached out to many more patients, and because it reached out to many more patients, it became cost effective, and the benefit of this minimal surgical trauma for a spay procedure has helped close to 40,000 patients in our city. So in order to take this procedure into the mainstream and into public's minds, into people's hearts, we undertook an event to undertake 50 laparoscopic spay procedures in the space of 8 hours, and this became a kind of national record and was registered with the Limca Book of Records in 2005. So the premise that we have worked on is that for removal of an ovary that we saw just now, that is 5, 6, 7 millimeter in size, we would really not need an incision that is 60 or 70 millimeters long, which is the standard spay incision in most of our surgeries. So this paradigm shift in selecting laparoscopic ovariectomy rather than open ovarian hysterectomy is one of our innovations. Obviously, there are patient benefits when we don't open up a patient for doing this surgery, and the patient goes back home with less risk of infection, less surgical trauma, and less pain. And this permits us also, because we are able to send patients back onto into their environments in a shorter 3-day period, it makes for a better and more economical use of the available hospital or kennel space that is available. So once again, what are the benefits of a laparoscopic procedure? You can see that your patient goes back with less trauma, less pain, less chances of infection. It's a bloodless surgery, it's a sutureless procedure, and there is minimum pain or postoperative care needed because of the surgical insert is of a much, much lesser order. So another comparison there, the infection chances are much higher in open surgery. In this procedure, you're able to do this with minimal surgical insert, minimal chance of risk of infection. You inflict minimal pain on your patients, there is less morbidity, and therefore your patients are much more mobile. Typically, you will see that this dog is back onto her feet the next day and is not really bothered or overcome by the surgical insult. So therefore, there is much less need for post-surgical stay in the kennel or in your hospital following this ABC procedure. So the shorter the stay of your patient in the hospital, the less the risk of hospital infections or transmissible diseases. So the less the chance that you see that this patient has picked up a viral infection or kennel cough or one of those hospital infections that can otherwise trouble many patients that you admit in your hospital. Therefore, it has a lot of potential on a case-to-case basis to be undertaken as a daycare surgery procedure. That is, your patient comes in the morning and goes back in the evening. If this is a compound dog, and in Bombay or Thane, there are many dogs that are in people's compounds. So there are these housing societies, multi-story buildings, and there are these dogs that are in the yard of the building. So these dogs go back the same day, and they're observed by their caregivers for a couple of days, and then they're fine. They typically need little or no care except for a long-acting antibiotic that we inject into them before release. So it also preserves much better because they are away from their regular environment for a much shorter period. It preserves their survival instincts better, and they get back to their social hierarchy very quickly, and they don't lose the space that they have vacated when they were brought into a hospital for surgery. So because of the obvious patient and program benefits, and because we are able to reach out to this technology to operate many more patients every day, and therefore this might very well be a much better option of using technology in the interest of serving our patients and serving our ABC programs. So we've had the privilege of conducting academic and training workshops at our center every quarter over the last several years. And we have reached out from north in Jammu and Meerut and Delhi and in Anand in Gujarat and in several towns in Maharashtra and in the northeast and in the south of India. We have conducted workshops at various locations to train professionals and to pass on the skills that we have so that they can use it for the betterment of their own patients. Finally, I leave you with some pictures from our hospital that is operational since 2009. And this is a dedicated laparoscopic neutering hospital in the outskirts of Bombay. So now I'm free to take any questions that you might have. And if I've missed any points and there's something that you'd like me to ask,
from the Food Cross Society of Pune, and we also run the ABC AR program. I have three questions. One is, based on experience, what would you say is the approximate cost per dog using this method? Secondly, what is the initial equipment investment cost? And the third is that I understand you're doing training. So is it possible that if we go into this program that your organization would come to our hospital in Pune and provide this kind of thing?
Okay, so gentlemen from Pune, from the Blue Cross of Pune, and I try and address each question one by one. So the first question is, what is the cost of this setup? So there are several options available. So you see there were five different pieces of equipment and several delicate instruments that I was handling. So there are some choices to be made. You might choose certain versions or certain modalities which might be more beneficial or which might be more cost effective. So the ballpark range or cost of starting off with your laparoscopy setup, considering that you probably already have a hospital, so the general infrastructure is already in place, then to augment that infrastructure in order to convert it into a laparoscopy setup will probably cost you maybe 11 or 12 lakh rupees. So 11 or 12 lakh rupees will be the reasonable cost, that and the equipment will be sturdy enough to run your program in the hands of a well-trained professional for several years. So my own equipment which I got in 2003 is maybe more than half of the equipment is fully functional still, but there are need for service and upkeep. So if I have a personal if I take personal interest in this equipment and I take good care of it myself, then it can last me for several years. So over several years this has probably benefited more than 25,000 patients. So you can understand that the distributed cost, when the cost of say 12 lakh or 15 lakh rupees is distributed over say 10,000 patients for a point, you get an idea that the cost per patient might not be more than 100 rupees or more than 150 rupees. So of course it has got to do with the kind of turnover you can achieve. The more patients that go through your service, the larger the number of patients that can go through your service and the lesser the cost per patient. So the basic cost might be the same. If you operate only one patient a day, then the cost per patient is higher. If you operate 10 patients a day, then the cost per patient definitely goes down a lot because there's not a lot of consumable cost, though there is cost of servicing and maintenance of this equipment. And your final question, I think, was about training. So we conduct intensive training programs in our hospital, and I would say that it is much easier to conduct a program where from where we are than to come to your place and conduct a training program. Because we will not be able to transport all the equipment to your hospital. If you were to have the equipment installed in your hospital, then your doctors could typically, a team of doctors could come over for training, and after an intensive course, they could go back and recreate the kind of procedure that we do in your own hospital themselves.
Just one add-on question. Based on your experience, what would be an average number of operations that a single doctor should be able to do per day under normal conditions, not trying to report?
So, it's a good question, it's a nice question. 50 surgeries is what I performed in 2005, 8 hours. I'm not Superman, you can see that I'm a frail individual just like all of us. So if I can do this, I think many trained professionals can do this. Typically, our doctors are pretty good at performing 25 to 30 laparoscopic procedures on a given day, and it does not consume more than half their working hours. So typically, I have four associates who work with us, and they work in a well set up hospital in an environment that is conducive for them to do this in a safe and repeatable manner for the benefit of patients, and they might be able to do typically 25 to 30 surgeries on a given month.
How do you make sure that the patient is not likely, especially if they fail very often? How do you address this?
Yeah, that's again an interesting and technical question. So, before we went in for the stay procedure, we examined the length of the uterus, and when we examined the length of the uterus, as all of us who have seen a uterus that is carrying the seed of pregnancy, you would see certain bumps there, and as early as 15 days into pregnancy, you would see some bumps, and these bumps are indicative of the conception inside, and if there is, then you know that this dog is pregnant, and probably should be converted into an open surgery for removal of the uterus and ovaries. So our surgeons will typically look at the uterus first, and they find it that it is not, then if it's not carrying any conceptus, then we will go ahead with the oophorectomy procedure.
Thank you, Doctor, for your explanation. What about the infection of the uterus? Sometimes the uterus gets infected, and that's the next possibility of the infection brought in other forms of life.
Okay. So, another question because we have made a step change from ovarian hysterectomy to oophorectomy, therefore I would have to answer this question, and this change is fully supported by scientific publications. So I must say that oophorectomy is the standard stay procedure in more than half of the Western world. So in all of Europe, so if you were to be in Utrecht where I trained, if you were to be in Belgium, if you were to be in Germany, if you were to be in Italy, if you were to be in Spain, and in all of Europe, if you were to be in the UK, then the standard spay procedure that would be undertaken for my own pet dog. I walk in with my own pet dog into a university hospital in anywhere in Europe, so the standard spay procedure is an oophorectomy. It is only removal of the ovaries that is the standard spay procedure, and it is well understood that the uterus may get infected only if there is underlying ovarian pathology. If there are cysts, if there are hormonal derangements which have affected the ovary, then the ovary may predispose the uterus to become infected. Now, when we remove the ovaries, then the uterus is spared the hormonal influences. So it is totally spared the hormonal derangements, and cysticity of the ovary is no longer possible. Since cysts cannot form on the ovary, therefore what is well known as pyometra or infection of the uterus is now well understood to be a cystic endometrial hyperplasia rather than an infection itself. So if cysticity of the ovary is not possible because the ovaries are not there, then the uterus cannot get infected, and this is very clearly borne out by scientific literature. And it is because of this reality that for the last 100 years all of Europe performs oophorectomy as a standard stay procedure, not just for ABC programs but for my own pet dog. So I have my own companion animal in my home, and I walk in into Utrecht University to spay her, and they will not ask me what manner of spay procedure I want. So it's clear and understood, and that's the only spay procedure that is done, oophorectomy.
I have two objects how to the dog. Good things for both of them. Also, what is the treatment? The second thing is, in case of cysts in the womb, it would be high and not high.
Okay, so postoperative infections are directly related to the extent of hygiene control that we exercise in our theater. So typically our theater staff does not change, and I'm sure that is true of many of the established neutering centers across the country. So we treasure our theater staff and cherish them greatly, because they are the infection preventers in our theaters. So they are the people who scrub clean our theaters, who scrub clean our instruments and make sure that the autoclave is up and running. They are the people who wash the plates and lay the sets. So infection control is an active pursuit, and this is something that all of us have to do. In the face of I have to specifically address this question about infections in a different surgery, in a laparoscopic procedure that we do, and my own experience, I have worked in ABC centers before I used laparoscopy, and I have seen that largely the infections are not internal, they are largely superficial. So the superficial infections are related to soilage of stitches. So clearly in a laparoscopic procedure there aren't that many length of stitches, there isn't that level of exposure of the abdominal wall during surgery, and infections are of a much lesser order. So maybe more than 15-20% of our patients are sent back home to compounds where dogs live in, and this is where animal welfare enthusiasts are picking up their dogs, compound dogs, and getting them to the hospital for neutering. So we have very good follow-up on these dogs, and we know that infections are really not a worry. Typically, we send patients away after a post-operative antibiotic. They also take a long-acting antibiotic, and the antibiotic will typically protect them against infection for a 4 to 5 day period. And infections are really not a worry, but I think it's a concern that we always keep a hawk eye for. We make sure that our staff is doing a good job of fumigating the theaters, is taking adequate care to sterilize instruments properly and effectively. And
what will you think?
So I would think that there is no peri-surgical mortality that I have faced. So what are the concerns and what are the particular areas of care? So this is something that we speak with and discuss intensely with the professionals or veterinarians who come in for training. So the typical areas that need particular attention are of insufflation. So when we use a gas to insufflate and the stent in abdominal cavity, then this is an area that we need to be very careful about. So the equipment has certain safety features. So the safety features of the equipment have to be matched by the safety attitude or the safety approach of our professionals. And typically, I feel with the hands of veterinary professionals, mortality is not an issue. Post-surgical or on-table mortality is really not an issue at all. And as you see, bleeding, there was not a spot of blood on screen. I hope all of you agree with me that there wasn't a spot of blood on screen. And that's another reason for me to say with confidence that since my patient doesn't lose blood on table, my patient goes back in reasonably the same fitness that she came in. And therefore, mortality is really not a worry when we do these procedures in a well-organized setup.
This is ovarian.
Finally, ovarian cysts. So cystic ovaries are seen. If I operate a dog, let's say a series of dogs that are 1 year old, and a series of dogs that are 2 years old, then the 2-year-old dogs tend to have a cyst or two compared to the 1-year-old dogs who might not have cysts at all. So the older the patient that we are taking up the surgery, the greater the chance that over successive cycles they have accumulated a cyst or two, and some of these cystic ovaries may not be very big. So typically you can crash these cysts while you operate, and the ovary becomes much smaller. So the cyst is filled with certain fluid, and the cystic fluid just escapes and it leaves you with a contracted ovary, which can be taken out pretty readily laparoscopically. So there is a rare patient, a very senior dog, let's say a 7-8-year-old dog, and I have seen large ovaries which have become severely cystic, and I can still operate these dogs laparoscopically. They are obviously not for the beginning laparoscopist. This is not a challenge that I would want a beginning laparoscopist to undertake, but in an experienced laparoscopist's hands, this can still be done laparoscopically. So what does happen though is that the exit incision might have to be a little larger in order for that larger cystic ovary to be removed. So the exit incision might not be 5 millimeter like it was today, but it might become maybe 1 centimeter, and might need a little more careful attention to closure.
This is only based on the ABC program. As you can see that you are inserting electronic equipment into the dog, what type of sterilization do you use for your equipment?
So that's a very nice question again. So I must make a small clarification that there isn't electronic equipment inside. So the equipments are mechanical equipments. I'm sorry, they packed up everything already. So I couldn't show you this, but these are hand instruments. First is a telescope. So the telescope is a solid rod which has lenses in it. So it's a solid tube which has lenses in it. There are no moving parts and there is no electronics within it. All the electronics is outside. So sterilizing this stainless steel rod is typically achieved by what is called as cold sterilization. It might mean that you use glutaraldehyde or formaldehyde and this is left to soak in this disinfecting liquid for about 10 to 15 minutes before the procedure. So these are not electronic. All the electronics is outside, and the outside electronic doesn't need sterilizing. Because that's not going to be in touch with the patient. So only those portions which are over the plate. So you saw a sky blue colored plate, and everything that comes over that should definitely be sterilized.
Just a question from you. You must have done so many of them, so you would be the best person to answer this question. What are the possible drawbacks of this technique that you must have felt at some day when you were probably beginning or say in the initial days? You must have felt there must be some drawback to this technique.
Yeah. So this is a question I was asked by somebody just before I stepped onto stage, and I'll tell you exactly what I told the lady before I stepped onto stage. I think there is a single drawback. And many of us think that it is economics of this. And I don't think it's the economics of this. So I must tell you quite clearly, as a young professional, when I started this, the single biggest drawback I faced was the extreme steepness of this learning curve. So I don't know if you're a professional or you work with professionals. So when your professional sets foot into this, then understanding the complexity of doing this and understanding correctly how to do this. Now, this is the most important thing. Now, the big plus is, while this was a drawback when I started in 1998, it is not a drawback anymore because there are training opportunities available for young veterinarians within India. So rotating with a hospital with a good caseload, working in an institute or an ABC program which has sufficient caseload for you to see all the different situations that you will encounter and which will prepare you to face those situations on your own, and this preparedness is really what you need to create, and that's your biggest asset. That's your biggest asset.
One more question. Other than oophorectomy, are there any other procedures you have attempted using this system?
So laparoscopy and endoscopy is used for a huge wide range of procedures, and it is increasingly challenging the surgical profession by replacing all those open procedures with endoscopic procedures. So like I was speaking again with somebody this morning, we do arthroscopy, which means that Sachin Tendulkar's bowling arm is trained. Sachin Tendulkar has sprained his bowling arm and he needs his joint examined. So 20 years ago, they would open up Sachin Tendulkar's shoulder and examine him for what the problem was. Now what that does to Sachin Tendulkar is it puts him off the cricket field for 9 months. And his shoulder is not the same. When he comes back onto the field, it's not quite the same. So there's arthroscopy. So you use a very fine arthroscope, a much slender version, a much finer version of the laparoscope that we use today to view inside the joint. So there is every manner of endoscopy that is being done now. So in our own clinic, we perform what is called flexible endoscopy or GI endoscopy. So an anesthetized patient swallows a tube and you can examine the insides. So I'm sure you've heard that a fractious dog swallowed a ball or swallowed a stone and it's stuck in his stomach and he's vomiting and he's in agony because of it. So you can go into the endoscope and pick out this stone or pick out this bunch of keys, and I've removed a bunch of keys, car keys, from a dog's stomach. And so you can do upper GI endoscopy. You can examine the colon if a patient has some colonic abnormality and you don't know whether it is just repeated colitis or there is a functional problem or there is a structural problem that has developed, then you can examine all parts of your organ systems. So there is otoscopy to examine the inside of my ear. You can examine the inside of my nose and nasal sinus. You can examine the airways. It's called bronchoscopy. So there are any number of minimally invasive diagnostic and surgical procedures that are being developed by talented professionals, and these are, every day they're beneficial to our patients to access all those remote areas in our body which we cannot open up to see. So an endoscope is literally your eye inside your patient. So you can examine many organs, many systems using endoscopy. And there is diagnostic and therapeutic benefit that patients would derive. And some of these we are beginning to provide in our own care.
Has anyone got any more questions?
Well, this is the ovary. If it is cyst is there, if it is broken inside, will it cause any problem in the viscera?
Dr. Chandra, Atul Tiwari.